Happy Thanksgiving. My dogs have been a giant pain all day, and yesterday, and the day before. But I think I have like 5 minutes of quiet, so maybe we can chat. It's been a little bit since I did one of these, you know, kind of vlog style videos, mainly because we had family in town, and it's always hard for me to kind of get back into the groove of stuff. I kind of use it as an excuse, but I think it's a bad excuse, but it's the excuse that I'm going with. My sister's fiance and my sister were here for a long weekend last weekend, and it just kind of like organized itself in the way that everybody was, you know, available at the same time. Like Kyrie worked the last two nights, she works tonight. She's on a 10-night stretch, which is going to be terrible. But she was off last weekend. And my sister and her fiance go up to his parents' lake house for Thanksgiving, so they're probably there now. And it just so happened that, you know, everybody had the time and could organize themselves down here. I mean, my folks live not that far up the road. So it's, you know, if we find some time, then, you know, we can organize it pretty easily. And I guess it doesn't really matter if we're on, like, the same, I don't know. I guess it doesn't matter if we're celebrating the main holiday with everybody on the day. It's just, you know, it's an excuse to kind of get together, and whatever day that is, it's kind of irrelevant. But I also gonna cook a turkey today. It's a spatchcock turkey. You take the spine out and you flatten it, but I don't think I flatten it all the way. You'll notice I have a thing over here. It's a microphone. Hopefully it works nicely for these sorts of videos. I think it will. Full disclosure, I had everything already, and I already talked to the camera for a while, but my microphone that I used to use for on top here is just one that you plug in, and it's a kind of a boom mic. It just goes on top of the camera, and it points to your face, and you talk to it. This one actually needs a cable that goes into the camera, and I did not plug it in, so the audio is crap, because I got up and let the dogs in and out because they were being a pain in the neck. And Bergie, for the love of God. Probably somebody walking outside or an Amazon guy or something, I don't know. Although there's a car in front of my driveway right now. Well, maybe that's just the Amazon delivery person on Thanksgiving. Why are you standing? Well, you're not standing, you're parked in front of my driveway. Okay. That's who that was. Oh, Marsha's outside. Team Oaf at the front door. Lately, a lot of my social media feed has been just full of the people with a lot of money to have like high production value things, and as much money as they have and as much confidence as they have, their understanding of medicine is, and the human body, frankly, is the opposite. Lately, it's been a lot of Gary Brecka stuff, and I was gonna react to one of his videos talking about insulin, because doctor, type 1 diabetic, fitness person, frankly, fitness, I'm gonna call myself a fitness expert because I am. The things that he said in the video was nonsense. Like, not just wrong, because there's a lot of stuff in there that's wrong, but just, it started with, fat doesn't make you fat, sugar makes you fat. It's like, well, excess of any sort of calories makes you fat, right? If you have 5,000 calories of protein every day, like, you're gonna get fat, unless you're, you know, a monster and, I don't know, working out constantly, but still. But this same thing happens with 5,000 calories of carbs, 5,000 calories of fat, more or less. And then he talks about how insulin's main role is to turn off like all the methods that your body uses to break itself down, which is technically something that it does. But insulin's main goal, its main role in the body, is to transport glucose into the cell. That's what it does. It just opens, it tells the channels, open up, here comes some glucose. And at the level of the fat cell, it shuts off lipolysis, or the breakdown of fatty acids, the breakdown of lipids. At the level of the liver, for example, it suppresses glucagon. Glucagon is responsible for taking long strings of sugar known as glycogen in the liver and chopping it up into glucose. That's called gluconeogenesis, or glycogenolysis, I guess. Gluconeogenesis, just Krebs cycle kind of backwards. So glycogenolysis, and essentially it's your body, it's insulin telling your body, hey, we have plenty, we have more coming in, we don't need to break down ourselves to get energy to perform the cellular processes that we're gonna perform. It's kind of like if you go out to dinner, right, and someone hands you, as you walk in the restaurant, someone hands you a gift card to that restaurant for $100. Why would you reach into your savings account to pay for the meal instead of using that $100 gift card that somebody just handed you, right? It's signaling the body that we have plenty. Why don't we just use the stuff that's coming in and hold off on breaking ourselves down because we don't need to? And it's a constant like pendulum, ebb and flow of building yourself up, breaking yourself down, you know, adding to your muscles, adding to your glycogen stores, adding to your fat stores, and breaking yourself down, subtracting from your glycogen stores, subtracting from your fat stores. And if you're in a deficit, and unfortunately you're going to lose some muscle when you're constantly in a deficit, but you try to minimize that with diet and exercise. I digress. But then he's talking about how when you can't break down fat, fat just builds up in the blood. And then he goes on to saying that's why people who consume lots of sugar have high blood fat. And I'm thinking, you use the words to string together the concepts, but the concepts are not stringing together properly. Right? When you have insulin and you're in an anabolic state, when you're trying to build yourself up, the fat gets taken up by the liver and the fat cells. Like, that's not the only thing that has to do with high blood fat. Right? There's a genetic component involved, sure. There's a dietary component involved a bit. There's an exercise component involved a bit. But that's not just how it works, right? You can have insulin spikes. Like Jordan Syatt did an experiment with this. I think it's like 30 days of spiking his insulin in a calorie deficit. And he lost weight, his cholesterol went down. I'll try to link it down below, because he does really well with all this stuff. And if you don't know who he is and you know who I am, not really sure how that happened. I have nothing but good things to say about his approach. I think we're a little bit different in our approaches, but I don't think I've ever had any problem with anything he has to say. There's a little troll under here. I don't know, people like Gary, who just say things that are very wrong constantly. Like his company's called 10X Health, right? And he's probably done a lot of good things for a lot of people. But the things that he will often say is they're just often so very wrong that they can be harmful to other people. Like he's talking about how One video I saw was like, ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, and celiac disease are, you know, this is what the GIs won't tell you. This is what the doctors won't tell you. Again, just pretending that he has more authority and pretending that he's smarter, is that it's just an issue with gut motility. I'm like, oh God. If someone actually like listens to him and does what he says to do to cure ulcerative colitis, that person will get colon cancer and will die. It's just as simple as that. For things like irritable bowel syndrome, right? Okay. You know, yeah. Fiber is good. Water is good. Exercise is good. Limiting things that trigger whatever it is that you have. If you have predominantly constipation, avoiding the things that make you constipated, fabulous. If you have mainly diarrhea, avoiding the things that give you diarrhea, fabulous. But for actual horrible diseases like celiacs, ulcerative colitis, Crohn's, just blows my mind that, like, and I think about this all the time too. It's like, I'm a firm believer that, like, freedom of speech is freedom of speech. You should be allowed to say whatever you want. But the problem I find with the internet is that people use that without any sort of, you know, recourse for being wrong, right? If you had a physician saying that, then their medical license would be revoked so quickly, because everything that he is saying is just incorrect. Not everything, actually. He said that when you eat, your insulin level rises. That is true. doesn't take a medical degree to know that, but sure. I mean, I guess the average person may not know that, because why would you have experienced it? But you can just kind of Google it. But then you build on this one thing that's accurate, and that anchors you into thinking that the rest of what he says is accurate, when it's just not even close. Okay, I need to, you know, not be riled up, and I need to go exercise. Delicious.
Bergie, do you properly mind?
If you can hear him, he's absolutely unloading on a bone right now. And Millie's at my foot. Wanting what, I'm not really sure. Don't sniff the camera. Well, you can't reach, even though it's on a coffee table that you should be able to reach. It was an eventful Thanksgiving. I think from when I left to go to the gym until, gosh, I don't know, until my parents got here at like 3:30, 3:45, it was like constantly doing stuff, because you, I don't know, maybe I'm the only one that has this problem, but I don't think so. It's a constant go, and then you realize that there may or may not be enough time between when you were supposed to have been done and now to get everything done. And I think there wasn't. I think I needed some help cleaning up before my folks got here, because I took like the world's fastest shower after going to the gym, trying to film a reel at the gym, and realizing that the lighting situation there sucks, so I just did it in the garage. And then doing it in the garage, realizing that the only thing that wasn't blurry was the bench. And like, I was super blurry the whole time, so I had to go do it again, which meant that I needed to Larson press 275
going through life
times,
constantly having to earn
your
food
at the gym.
Not a good idea.
And then a couple times, like the first time I tried it in the garage, and then cooling down, watching the video back, and realizing I had to do it again. So then having to do it again. Of course, you know, the second and third time you feel something, you just kind of go through it pretty quickly, because you've seen it before, you've done it, but that was really kind of annoying, I'll be honest with you. Turkey came out pretty nicely, actually. it's hard to get good at cooking something when you have only yearly practice, but I was pleased with how it came out. The skin was nice and crispy. I think I kind of over-seasoned it. I had never really dealt with a compound butter before, but I think I did okay. Everybody seemed to like it. They probably, no, that's not true. They would definitely tell me if it was terrible. And then Mr. Bergie got some time playing with the ball outside. It's like his favorite thing to do in the world. Because he's a wolfhound and they're prone to bloat, like he had a gastroplexy, which means they just kind of staple the stomach to his chest wall so it doesn't like invert when he eats too fast or if he runs. It makes it less likely, it doesn't mean it's not gonna happen. So we waited a pretty long time. We waited for him to be very calm after dinner. And then we go outside and I just throw this, for some reason he loves this ball, I just throw this ball for 20, 25, 30 minutes and his tongue goes sideways.
Boogie, how's that tongue doing?
A little floppy? A little sideways?
Alright, fine. Here you go.
Unfortunately, there wasn't a huge dessert this time, or there wasn't really... I didn't really have any dessert. My mother made some, like, white chocolate oat cookie things. There was a nut in there somewhere. I don't know what kind of nut it was, though. Kira liked them. I didn't really have any, because... It was at that point that I realized that I go see a new endocrinologist tomorrow. Not that having a cookie or two is gonna throw off my A1C, because I know that's not how it works. It's just, it wasn't really worth the impending glucose spike that I was gonna have. If it was apple pie and ice cream, that's a different story, worth it every time. But it was not. Hello, Marsha. Rush over here. Hey, come here. They can kind of see you in the corner. Nope. Okay. that's tomorrow. Haircut the following day. And at some point in there, I need to return some lights and change some other lights because when you look at these lights outside, it's hard to tell in the camera, but let's get out of the way there. Oh, oh boy. So these lights are a different color than these lights. And it, I don't know, if it was just for like Christmas time, it would look nice, but it's not. So I get to go do that again too. And don't worry, my leg is fine on the ladder. As though you're worried, come on. Bruin has put himself to bed. He knows when it's time, he just insists on going in there. And now Bergie and Marsha are sharing the same bed as Marsha waits for Bergie to be done with his bone. And Millie is doing laps looking for a friend. Womp womp. That's enough for me today.